Okay, let's go ahead and get started. Welcome everyone to another CAN Seminar Series presentation. And for today, we are quite privileged to have one of our own actually coming back to us. That's one of our own graduates, Dr. Lev Kazanovic, who is a professor at the University of Minnesota. And actually, a little bit of background about Professor Kazanovic. Lev, our good friend. Well, he's a professor, as I said, specializing at the University of Minnesota, specializing in payment research. But a little bit of background about him. He did his PhD at UIUC for sure. But before that, he had a BS degree from Leningrad Institute of Civil Engineering in Russia. And then during his PhD work here, he was working with Professor Tasso Sainidis and then Professor Bernie Barenberg. And several years, I think, after that, he was working here at RS Consultants. And then he moved up to Minnesota to take the teaching position. And, well, in the meantime, I just need to mention that during all that time, all the HASHTO, 2002 guide, that's how it started then, Mechanistic Empirical Payment Design Guide. He's basically the person behind all the concrete payment analysis parts that build into the analysis engine. I know some of his work from ICELAB, ICELAB 2000, but all the generated solutions of ICELAB 2000 programmed into the actual MEP, DG, and payment ME solutions as neural networks, he was involved in all of those. So he's the person who knows the rigid payment side and who feels very good about the rigid payment side of the payment ME program. He's going to talk to us about exactly that, the design of concrete payments, past, present, and future. With that.
Thank you very much, Errol, for a very nice introduction. It's good back to be here. It's my home. Well, before I start, I will make a few comments. First of all, the topic of my presentation is mechanistic empirical design. And in academia, design is a dirty word. You don't want to talk too much about design. You'll score much more points if you're talking about nonlinear, dynamic, viscoelastic, plastic modeling of something, especially on a nano level. Somebody has to do design, and if academia doesn't do it, who is supposed to do it? It's number one. Second, as Errol mentioned, I graduated from this university, and well, actually, I started my PhD study a little bit more than 25 years ago, and it's a good time to come home and reflect what's changed and what's different. What stays the same is at that time, University of Illinois was one of the best civil engineering program in the country, and it's the same now. And you guys are our future. It's our best hope, and you are taking courses and you're advised by the best faculty, not just in the country but in the world. And so basically, enjoy this time. Another comment is. Let's try to debug. Something here. No? Okay. A couple of years ago, I made a presentation at the International Conference for Concrete Payments, and the presentation was titled A Confession of a MEPDG Developer. But it was impossible to confess in all these scenes in 20 minutes. Let's consider the kind of a continuation of this confession process. It's a confession 2.0. So basically, how I structure this presentation, I'll talk about past in concrete pavement design, basically the world before the MEPDG. For many of you, it's the time before you were born, so you may not even be able to recognize that many concepts which you are taught now, and it looks that they be around forever, they're actually a relatively new concept which introduced in the last 20 years. But some fundamental concepts were around for quite a while. The present MEPDG and whatever it goes around it, and we'll, I try to talk about future, which is really difficult to talk about, predict anything except including future. But I'll talk about some work which we are working on right now, and it's not even published, so we'll actually have to submit a report to NCHRP tomorrow, so we'll see how it goes. Well, let's start from the beginning of the pavement engineering, and the person who really started at least concrete pavement field is Professor Vestergaard. He was a professor here at the University of Illinois. And later became a professor at Harvard University. And his work was fundamental not only to pavement engineering, but also the fracture mechanics. His 1939 paper is a fundamental and a very important for any person who is studying fracture mechanics and will know Vestergaard's function. It's basis for linear fracture mechanics. Anyway, but his 1926 paper, that's what actually started concrete pavement field. It was first a rational solution, rational approach for concrete pavement design, and I would strongly recommend you to read that paper. The way it's actually probably one of the most brilliant papers I ever wrote. He started from basic equations, which show later. He showed very rigorous mathematical solution, and it's easy to stop there. But he made the next step. He presented his solution as an infinite series, truncated it, and got his famous Vestergaard formulas, which have been used for design for years after that. So basically, he started from very rigorous mathematical solution and ended with a very simple, practical formula, which is still rigorous, accurate, but easy to use. So talking about Vestergaard model, which is still used in the modern design, including MEPDG, he proposed to use to model concrete pavement as a plate resting Winkler foundation. And because of that, we could describe this system using one differential equation instead of a system of differential equations in varied elastic theory. And basically, and he introduced this radius of relative stiffness, which is a very important scaling factor. As you see later, by normalizing coordinates to that scaling factor, we can get fundamental solution, basically, which are independent from many other parameters. Now, so in addition, he solved the three very important problems, interior loading of the slab, edge loading, and corner loading, you know. And in the past, I always present equations in the class, but in reality, you can present on a plot. So basically, if you have normalized radius of applied load, radius to radius of relative stiffness, normalized non-dimensional stresses, you can see edge loading stresses for wide range of A over L. Well, again, A over L is small. That's important, less than, let's say, 0.2. So they are always higher than corner loading and always higher than interior loading. So why it's important for us right now? So basically, now equations are not important. We can solve this, even full-blown equations in the computer in a matter of seconds, but it will not change anything. What's important, age is always higher, and critical solution for the edge are actually at the bottom of the slab, and they are always higher, about 50% than top stresses which produced by corner loading. So now, what does mean? It means that for a long time people sincerely believed that cracking in concrete pavements, at least transverse cracking, was always initiated at the bottom and propagated to the top. That's what the theory says. How to mitigate it? Increase thickness, increase concrete strength, decrease modulus of elasticity. The last probably it might be a problem, because if you decrease modulus of elasticity, you will increase corner deflections, and that will increase subgrade damage. So basically people were kind of trying to emphasize this modulus, but for a long time, when we're talking about pavement design, we meant make pavement sufficiently thick or make concrete sufficiently strong. That's it. Vestergaard also gave a solution, well, and here I'm repeating it because you know all this, but just to make a point, for kernel solution, so basically daytime, we have tension at the bottom, compression at the top, nighttime, tension at the top, compression at the bottom. Again, if you start measuring temperature gradients in the slab at daytime and nighttime, you find out that daytime gradients are greater, nighttime are smaller. So in this case, again, stresses at the bottom of the slab are always higher than stresses at the top. In this case, critical stresses, it also brings back the point that cracks should initiate at the bottom, propagate to the top. Now, Vestergaard recognized that his closed form solutions are not perfect. So had single slab, infinite in horizontal dimension, single layer, full contact with the foundation, single wheel load. So, and he worked on addressing those limitations until the end of his career, until 1950s. But only with the introduction of finite element method, we were able to address all these problems, and there's many programs developed. The most important of is ILIS Lab, developed by Professor Berenberg. And we went through many, many editions, and eventually we rewrote it in a more computationally efficient and user-friendly program, ISLAB 2000. But basically, all the ideas came from original Berenberg and the Batabai work with just some relatively minor improvements over the years. So from stress point of view, yeah, there were improvements, but from the design point of view, when I came like 25 years ago, the rule of the law of the land was Ashtar. And because in 1960 they had to build interstate highway system and they need something, a procedure to design pavement, so they built Ashtar road test, and they developed a placeholder solution to allow quick design. But as people say in Russia, there is nothing more permanent than temporary solutions. And over the years, those Ashtar equations were revised, and people learned how to build pretty good pavements using this procedure. Well, the entire Ashtar 93 procedure is here. This one equation, don't ask me to try to justify it. The only thing I say, in many cases, produce reasonable thicknesses. Again, what it says, to make pavement long, last longer, which means survive more easels, you need to increase thickness, and you need to increase, what is this, flexural strength. That was the main point, although it has some mechanistic features, so basically subgrade K values, modulus of elasticity, so you see it kind of reminds Vestergaard's radius of relative stiffness a little bit. But overall, it's simple empirical equation. And again, there is nothing wrong with this. if it produces good designs, so what? Alternatively, PCA come up with a little bit more mechanistic design, which used to be PCA design procedure, now street pave, basically it's the same concept. That procedure, is, again, is based on Vestigar directly, and to use some Ashtaro test results to calibrate it. And what is important here is, first of all, it's ignored curl, it ignores curling. Second, to justify use of stabilized base, they say, well, if you build your pavement on a stabilized base, you can increase K value. And if you increase K value, then Vestigard loading stresses decrease. In this case, we predict pavement will last longer, and you might have a thinner slab. So it's, again, this procedure was alternative to Ashton 93, gives more or less similar results, well, except for thinner pavements. So basically, that was the state of the art 25 years ago. And basically, although there was a understanding that we can do better, and there is a need and better design procedures, but on the other hand, it was considered like a natural evolution. The main so basically, I forgot to say this is fatigue and erosion, but you guys know it, so you don't need to bother. Where the main, where the game changer came is a failure of I-80 highway in Pennsylvania. So what happened there, it was reconstructed in 1993. PennDOT decided to play safe, and they built 13-inch thick concrete pavement over asphalt-treated base, permeable asphalt-treated base. Design life was 40 years, but in a few years, transverse cracking appeared. The first reaction was, oh, just shrinkage cracking, so no problem. But, the second problem was that maybe it's a thickness deficient or strength is not correct. Nope. Course shown that thickness was right and strength was high. Now, so maybe shrinkage cracking, but number of cracks kept increasing with years, and there were definitely structural cracks. Another very interesting observation was from those course, those cracks that you see, I hope you see it from the bottom, from the back of the room, the cracks were initiated from the top, propagate to the bottom. In this particular case, it's stopped somewhere, but in a few years, they will go through. So it's a clear structural crack initiated from the top. But just wait a second. Our Vestigard theory says that cracks should initiate at the bottom, propagate up. So now you know the solution, but at that time, 20 years ago, it was kind of, it's a paradox. So now we had a problem. Our empirical design procedure told us this pavement should last for 40 years. It lasts for 3. Now, our best mechanistic design procedure says that stresses at the bottom are much higher than stresses at the top. The pavement failed from the top. Fortunately, and unfortunately, it was a kind of perfect storm to solve this problem. So on the one hand, we just finished ISLAP 2000. And I said, although conceptually it's the same as all ILISLAP, but it was much more computationally efficient. It has graphical user interface. We could analyze large number of cases really fast. And that's what we did. So basically what we've done, we immediately build this model. The second positive event, we were working on the, what at that time called 2002 design guide. So we felt it's really important to address this issue, otherwise, well, why we're working on a new design procedure. So basically what we've done, we build a model, we put like tandem loads at the center of the slab, tandem load at the slab edge, And of course, solution, we used actual measured temperature gradients, 15 daytime minus 10 Celsius nighttime. And of course, stresses at the bottom were much higher than stresses at the top. So, that's right. Okay, after that we thought, well, we are considering only one axle. What will happen if we add another axle? Because we have a track. So we added, and stresses became slightly higher, but still low. And after that, we used this information. So at that time, Mike Darter went to Chile, and here he took that picture. It was just was an interesting picture, so with this Juan Pablo Caravises, who brought him to the payment. You see it's daytime, naturally, otherwise you won't be able to take this picture. And according to Vestergaard theory, the slab should curl in opposite direction. But you can see a shade from the string. So the only way to explain it is what you now, all of you know, is that it's built-in curl. And actually, the concept of built-in curl was first introduced in Germany by Eismann and Leiker. And later we used this concept to explain discrepancy between measured deflections and strains on one of the pavements in Colorado. But up until now, it was considered, okay, it's a good theoretical concept with no real practical application. So after we, this IAT project was the first project when we really used it to explain something real in the field, this mode of failure, which basically it means that to make the slab flat, you have to apply a positive temperature gradient through the system. And that gradient is called built-in curl. And when we put it in, we got stresses at the bottom of the slab higher than at the top. And there is another observation, they occupy much greater area. And because of that, in this particular case, it's easy to explain why the pavement failed from the top and not from the bottom. So what was in the immediate effect of that study? Number one, we decided that we must incorporate built-in curl into pavement design. Again, it wasn't in the proposal for the 2002 guide development. That decision was made after this project. And the second, we have to include top-down cracking in the design. For you guys, it's now like self-evident. And more you're analyzing pavement to me right now, you see that for most cases, at least for thick pavements, cracks start from the top, propagate to the bottom. That wasn't the case when I was a student here. So that was the result of this study. Now, so that was kind of a past. And what followed? Well, as I said, we decided to incorporate it into guide. Another was very important observation that thick pavement and high strength do not necessarily mean great performance. Especially, and that was Professor Rossler shared with me when he was a postdoc at Berkeley, when they built a high strength slab in Palmdale and it failed. Very high strength concrete, but high built-in curl. The pavement failed much faster than normal strength concrete would fail. But so now when I talk about built-in curl, you're talking about something self-evident. Although at the end of the presentation, I will try to kind of create reasonable doubts that everything is so self-evident. But that was, again, as a result of the project, and we decided to incorporate it into payment, what's now payment EMEA. And you saw the slide many, many, many times. So basically what this payment EMEA or MEPDG or whatever, 2002 guide means, we take climate, we have traffic, put in structure, create response, damage, and cracking. Well, my main job was to do this part. And currently, when you run payment PME or PDG, you just click a button and it will perform simulations. But when we started this project, Dr. Mike Darter, by the way, here we should make a very important statement. Errol said that I'm a guy behind the design guy and the rigid part. And it's incorrect. My job was implement Mike Darter's vision, the guy. It was Mike Darter's design procedure. He had a vision and he allowed us to do what we wanted to do to implement that vision, but it was his procedure. But and basically his vision was that we should not compromise on should make any assumption before the design. So this is important, it's not to make equivalency statements. What we need to do is put all the inputs design procedure and let the program decide what's important and what's not. It's easy to say though, but now I had to develop a stress computation procedure which would account for axial weight, axial geometry, axial position, how far from the pavement edge, different temperature gradients, properties of the concrete layer, property of the slab, of the base, property of subgrade, different joint spacing, low transfer efficiency, of course now a built-in curl was added. So how to do it? One of the easy way to do it, just implement a finite element program inside and run it in the background. But at that time, it would take for iSLAB about a minute to simulate a single case. So if you, we had to run, I don't remember exactly, I computed before about 100,000 cases for a single design iteration. So you see how long would it take. Now it will be a little bit faster, maybe 100 times faster, but still 1,000 minutes, it's not a negligible time. So we had to do better. And so Mike didn't want to compromise on this factorial. So in this case, we had to use dimensional analysis and similarity concept, which I briefly present next. And we use neural networks to train it. But what's important though, so neural networks are a very simple tool. So you create your training database, you train it, you get your output. Well, it's a black box, but you can reproduce the results. But in our case, neural networks on its own were useless because, think about it, if you just consider each parameter, like about 30 plus parameters, and try to train, to create training database, let's say two cases for each parameter, 2^30, it's already hundreds of millions of cases, you won't get any accuracy. But you had to build a huge database, so it's impossible. So what we decided to do, we use similarity concept. And idea is that you might have several very different systems with kind of complex thermal loading. But you can, in many cases, you can obtain a solution from one system if you know solution now. You have to make several steps. For example, if you have multi-layered system here, you have to convert it to a single layer system. If you have nonlinear temperature gradients, that was analyzed in the MEPDG, you have to convert to, well, you can ignore linear constant gradients because it's just expansion and contraction, but you need separating to bending and self-equilibrating nonlinear temperature distribution. And after that, but that's what the similarity concept, and that's where what's used to reduce the factorial drastically. If certain non-dimensional parameters like ratio of slab length to radius of relative stiffness, aggregate interlock in the joints to the subgrade key value and radius of relative stiffness, and on, if they are equal, then you can obtain solution from one system to another. The most, this is a definition for linear temperature gradient, how you can work from to another. It's actually in chapter 7 of my PhD thesis, so that's simple. But what's non-trivial is this non-dimensional temperature gradient theory, which I found in an old Russian book by Karenev in 1962, where it was given without derivation as a self-evident quantity. But we made an extensive check, and actually, yes, it does work. So if the two systems have the same non-dimensional temperature gradient, then you can convert stresses from one system to another, and this is a very simple closed-form solution of converting stress from one system to another, and this is a now, basically, we managed to build database for single layer slab for a very limited number of parameters and extrapolate that factorial for basically almost any design which combination which we need in MEPDG. So in that work drastically. And just to close on MEPDG, so basically that was fatigue damage. That's why we need so many calculation, because we want to have this allowable number of load repetition and depends on ratio of strength to stress, and this for different temperature gradients, loads, axial positions, season, and on and on and on. So, and that's a final calibration. This is our fatigue equation. I would like to point out it because it caused me a lot of grief when I we finished the design guide project, as you will show you later, and the equation was different, but in the manual of practice, that's what they published, and I was convinced that that change happened after I left ARA. So over the years, I converted all my class notes, and now I have to do it back, but show you later. Now, another stuff, so it's very important for procedure which we developed, that it's not only stresses are rigorous, but what we predict is actually corresponds to what we see in the field. And the MEPDG went through rounds of calibrations, and this is one of the last round of calibration. Actually, it was conducted at the University of Pittsburgh, but it's very similar to what was done by ARA during the last calibration. And you see it's remarkable feed between observed and predicted stresses, cracking. Of course, there is a scatter, but our models are not accurate, our measurements are not accurate. So, for example, if we say that this cracking was, let's say, 38%, and it happens like after 15 years, the number of cracks depends on and the person who count them, so it's easy to miss or see something extra. We think that it happened like in year 15, but it might be the first survey we had, and maybe it was there for the last 6 years. We just nobody measured it. So basically, there are many, many errors. Our estimation of traffic is rough. Our climate simulation, well, it's only as good as we can do it. So basically, you can't expect much better field. But on the other hand, there is a danger in plots like this either, because it creates an impression that the model is perfect. At least it looks very intimidating for me. And unfortunately, there is a lot of room for improvements. And if you really dig in appendixes of the guide, you will see some fine print. And this fine print is often more important than bold statement like this, and I'll show you later. Well, now, so basically, this MEPDG was developed, was voted, like, was developed in 2002 to 2004. It was adopted by us in 2008. In the first few years, there was a like propaganda period, so I felt very uncomfortable to bring attention to any problems in the PDG, because it was important to make sure that it's implemented before we start criticizing it. But now it's look, it's well, because you can't wait until we develop a perfect solution. So it's still much better than what we had before, but still it's. But now it's time to just be a little bit more realistic. Well, first of all, the design guide has many, many inputs. And what Mindat's experience about it? So that people will take MEPDG software and, well, they scratch, well, I have a budget for 6-inch thick pavement. And I have about 10,000 trucks per day. How can I design my payment so it will, how use payment to me to justify this? And they've managed to do it. Or another, I have a budget for 10-inch thick payments. I don't have any traffic, but it's my lifetime opportunity to build a payment. So let's use a payment to me, justify it. And people do it. And after that, the central office had to spend days and days to back engineer and find out what went wrong. So they, and after that, they hired me and say, well, we should do something with this and I'll show what we've done. The second, but that's a practical issue, and that itself can be addressed by better education, better training, and the tools which we develop. But there is a bigger problem for research. Documentation does not reflect software. And that's a problem with the NCHRP process. A secrecy around MEPG development was comparable to Manhattan Project development. I can understand why, at least intention of a secrecy around Manhattan Project, although in reality, Stalin knew about Manhattan Project much better than American Congress was aware of this. So that was discovered recently. So that secrecy failed either. Secrecy around MEPDG was much more successful. I'll show you examples later. But I don't know what they were trying to achieve with this. But now, but currently, if you develop, there is basically improvement of this procedure is extremely difficult because, well, first of all, you don't know what's really inside. Even I don't know what's inside rigid payment software completely. I have to back engineer it. I have my own tools to do it. But again, it's, if it's normal or not, that's another story. But basically, but the second, there is no good framework to incorporate new models there. That's, well, we can't do anything with the last one. But basically, it's a problem and that needs to be addressed in the future. Well, this audience can do it. I would try to emphasize some what we discovered here. But basically, another major improvement is needed, especially for the design of overlays. So unbounded overlays, white type. And when we started the design guide development, the main objective was to improve overlay design procedures. When we finish it, when we're on a finish line, run out of money, out of energy, out of time, we felt that we did a reasonably good job for design of new payments. The overlay is still placeholder. And that's basically, which good news for you guys. So you'll have something to work on for the next 25 years. But let me talk about, first of all, simplification coming down. So basically what Mindat decided to do, we decided to let's fix some inputs. And we let's run large number of cases for MEPDG, for Minnesota specific conditions, and run neural networks on the damage generated from those runs. And after that, develop our own royalty-free software, which can be used for design and should be very simple. And that's what we end up with, very simple procedures. So you specify, well, your project, district. So basically we have nine districts in Minnesota, nine climatic zones, if you want to see. Design life, traffic, growth, type of axial spectrum. There we allow three types of axial spectrum, if it's wide lane or not, joint spacing, shoulder type. We hit run and we'll get thickness at the end. That's it. So it takes seconds to run, a fraction of a second to run, and basically allows to avoid many errors. And I mean, that's already using it as a main tool for the last year. Of course, you see there is, we slightly oversimplified, so there is no base type here, and that's what work of Professor Toto Muller will really help us to incorporate those inputs. There are some, only one subgrade type here, so we need to expand it, and that's what the second phase of the project which we're working on right now, basically building a simplified version of this program, which is called MinPaveRigid. Well, it's recorded, but I still say it. We call it internally MEPDG 4D, which means MEPDG for dummies. But it's a black box, and a very simple tool, but that allows really move on with the implementation of payment to me. And the idea is that if a qualified consultant would come and say, well, we know what we're doing, they don't have to use this tool. They can use full-blown payment to me. But for if a consultant yesterday designed sewage and tomorrow is going to design traffic lights, but today they design payments, they must use this software. So basically, they are not allowed to use payment to me. Again, that's, on the other hand, well, another confession, of course, we could not reduce this project for just running MEPDG software. We made some changes to reliability analysis. So we went to many payments measured with ultrasound concrete thickness, developed our coefficient for in-situ thickness variation and for Minnesota payments. We analyzed large number of beam data, and we generated reliability procedure, which is Monte Carlo based rather than what's there in MEPDG, and which are in the future it might help to build performance related specification, but it's not there yet. So currently it's used only this one. So to change all our parameters, you have to need a password and get access to more information. And again, but the beauty of the output is just thickness and it's done. Now, let's talk about second issue, fatigue model. That's what in the manual of practice, that was an original report. It took us significant efforts in back engineering to show now that's a correct equation. I bring in it just an example, I'll show another example. So there is a need to kind of unclassify MEPDG, document really what's inside and eliminate stuff like this. In this particular case, might say typo. There are some other examples which I'll show you later, which are not as innocent as this one. And well, actually this example. So basically, as I said, in a very important part of the MEPDG was conversion of the nonlinear temperature gradient to linear temperature gradient and nonlinear temperature stress at top at the bottom. But the problem is, if you start computing this nonlinear temperature stresses directly, periodically you get very, very high numbers, either the top or the bottom, mainly the top. And you show that failure, you predict failure much faster than we observed in the field. So what ARA has done with this, and here I'm not 100% sure because it's a little bit more complicated and I didn't have access to the entire code, but I kind of back engineered. They just reduced nonlinear temperature stress by they introduced this coefficient 0.4. This coefficient is not published anywhere. It's just our back engineering. And it's a good practical solution. There is nothing really wrong with this if it's documented and published, if you don't have to back engineer. But, well, but it's there, and I believe they slightly changed the definition of temperature gradient as well. So it's not rigorous, and when we recently started working on the revision of the Kraken model, we say, well, we should do better. And our concept was, well, let's keep rigorous stress calculation. Yeah, just a second, before I move on. Another very important factor is, remember, talked about built-in curl. And we introduced it as a parameter. But on the other hand, we said, well, we can't develop guidelines how users should provide it. So let's use built-in curl minus 10. And even if you, in one of the latest version of MAPDG software and PayMetMe, this input is grayed out, so we make it very difficult for the user to change it. Because we didn't want people to play with that parameter design whatever payment they want. But, it's easy to tell other people not to do it. But when you can do it, it's difficult to resist not to do it. Now, and that's what our evaluation of the latest ASHTA recalibration procedure, you see the large number of sections have built-in curl, which is not default. And it can be as high as minus 40 and as small as zero. So basically, we calibrate the model using individual built-in curl parameters. And after that, we tell people, design a payment with minus 10. It can be a problem. Now, why it's a problem? So let's look again. You saw this plot, perfect calibration. Now let's rerun the same projects with built-in curl minus 10. And you see, for granular basis, it's still not bad, not, at least not biased. But for semi-untreated basis, R square is 0.22 and a slope is 0.14, not even close. Now, for permeable treat basis, actually, it looks scary, it's a negative trend, but in reality, there are not too many points to begin with. For the majority of sections, damage is zero. Well, so we thought that we could do better. So what we decided to do, well, first of all, we didn't have to, but we wanted to get rid of this fudge factor for stress calculation. At least sample should be rigorous. If it's the sample should be stresses. But we should understand that we use in our fatigue equation modulus of rupture, which is a stress at which 6 by 6 by 18 beam fails and simply supported beam fails on the lab. Is it really fundamental strength of concrete? And you guys can tell me better, it's not. So it's just an index. So in this case, we can adjust that index. Because we know, like if you have a crack in your payment, partial crack, you can't even use closed, so you need something else. So now, we didn't want to use this full-blown fracture mechanics, but we use very simple concept which kind of simulates. We say, let's say we have bending, total stress. We have another stress profile with the same stress at the top, but you see stress rapidly decrease here. And now we have the same stress at the top, but stress decreases much slower. According to current MEPDG procedure, these payments fail at the same time. But it's clearly, this will survive much more load repetition like this and much fewer like this than this. So we introduced the two correction factors. So now one is for stress state, another actually observation that curing condition at the top of the concrete is different than at the bottom, so we can reduce strength at the top compared to the bottom by about like 5%, but still it's important. And after that, we used energy concepts, so basically the energy of elastic deformation before failure should be the same. So we introduced another stress point, a certain characteristic depth from the surface. By default, it's 2.5 inches, approximately twice maximum aggregate size, and use this correction factor. So this correction factor is for strength is more than one if stress decreases faster than in bending, and it's less than one, then its stress is more uniform. Another, and I'm running out of time, but another concept which we developed, currently MEPDG uses one built-in curl for design process. At the same time, if you go back to original concept, we say built-in curl depends on paving condition. Paving conditions are not the same even during the day. In the morning and the afternoon, if you pave in the morning or in late afternoon, the condition of which concrete will cure will be totally different. How we can come up with one number, especially if we have cement-treated base below, which will describe this process, it's impossible. So what we proposed to use two built-in curl. So in this case, we don't need to play between top and bottom damage and shift it in one another direction. So we proposed one built-in curl for bottom-up damage, one for top-down damage. And we say that we developed this equation, which adjusts this depending on stiffness of the base layer, relative stiffness of the base layer compared to stiffness of a concrete slab. So, and after we've done it, we recalibrate the model, and you may not see this huge improvement in overall field because the original was actually pretty good before, but if you see in this case, this we used default built-in curl, what using that equation for all sections except two, actually we slightly adjusted, and so there is no bias for base type, so we do believe that this model is more stable and more robust. In addition, it allows to use partial interface between concrete and partial bond interface between concrete and cemented base, but we did not recommend it for routine use, it's more for research use. So basically, that's what our latest recommendation. We are going to submit it to NCHRP, and we'll see how it will be received. So that's part of the promised future stuff. I have a few more slides. One of the problems with the MEPDG is that it predicts only transverse cracking, which is for a long time was the main mode of failure in concrete pavements. But now if you run pavement to me and you choose widened lane, you will see that you can make pretty damn thin pavement with zero cracking. And I would say it's absolutely correct prediction. What the guy doesn't tell you that your pavement will fail in longitudinal cracking, which is in reality a much bigger problem than failing in transverse cracking. If I have to choose in what mode my pavement should fail, I would rather say let it fail in transverse cracking. But currently we don't analyze longitudinal cracking, we don't predict it. So we can expect that that mode will be prevailed in the future. So we had to develop a very simple tool how to at least highlight the problem. So it's basically when we're dealing with transverse cracking, we're dealing with the stresses longitudinal direction, either the bottom or the top. To check longitudinal stress, we have to check them at the joints, both top and the bottom. But on the other hand, we didn't want to start all the spiel of the MEPDG from scratch. We want to find out what the conditions are critical for longitudinal cracking. So basically what we analyzed, what we say that if we have, for example, critical condition for bottom of the PC slab, axle is between this joint, if this axle moves, sooner or later, it will hit the joint. And in this case, we moved it different position axle, but basically critical stress might be somewhere here. So how to compare stresses here and stresses here? Of course, we can run different cases and consider, but we decided to use, again, this relationship. And you see in this case, nonlinear temperature stress is the same, so we don't need to worry about it. These correction factors are the same. So in this case, why do we need to consider stresses in the real space if we can compare them in transform space? In this case, let's run, again, a factorial similar to what we've done for MEPDG neural network development, probably in this case about 20,000 points here. And we see if we have standard width slab, it's difficult to find a case, maybe somebody, it's a few cases here, when stresses at the longitudinal stress, which cause transverse cracking, are greater than transverse stresses, which cause longitudinal cracking. It's, this study is slightly misleading because in reality, we don't need, in real life, we need to change the slope of this curve as a cutoff criteria because there is a, the damage is slightly different. But at this stage, we wanted to simply just keep it for pure stress comparison. But now, next step, if we use widened slab, in a huge number of cases, transverse stresses which cause longitudinal stress, longitudinal cracking are greater than longitudinal stresses which cause transverse cracking, which means that we actually we have to, if we have a widened slab, we have to design against longitudinal cracking, not against transverse cracking. That slide clearly illustrated, and that's another very important problem which should be addressed sooner or later, and basically that's another challenge for you guys. Now, but again, but it's, this plot shows actually power the similarity concept. So you, basically all the possible combinations of design conditions, you can only imagine for normal design type stuff, are here. So we're talking about this 10,000-20,000 cases in reality represents hundreds of millions, if not billions, cases which you need to analyze. That's the power of the similarity concept. Well, so that's already running out of time, but just to conclude, the MEPDG did make a difference. It's really a significant paradigm shift in the way how we analyze at least concrete payments. But on the other hand, it's never been intended, and it's not a solution of all the problems with the design. When I started my PhD program, I was afraid that I would solve all the problems in the first year, and I won't have enough material to finish my thesis. 25 years later, I still have quite a few exciting problems to work on, and I can assure you that there is enough problem just in concrete payments for this audience, if you decide to choose from black to white, which in my opinion any reasonable person should do. But again, but there is enough problems for you and actually for the generations to come. So future of concrete payment research is exciting, and it's never been a better time to be in concrete payment field than now. That concludes my presentation, and I will be happy to answer any questions you might have. Thank you.
Lev, on one of those, you were adjusting your factor for the built-in curl based yes. on the modulus of the base course.
Yeah.
What's your impression? Would you rather have a cement-treated base or back off and go to something like, asphalt-treated base?
Well, it might be the best. If I, well, the best base type is asphalt, definitely. But I would run them asphalt, high-quality granular base, cement-treated base.
Our experience shows that the cement in the base, unless you are following German design, which they are part of it recently, for cost reason, you might get a great performance with cement in the base, but you might get a great failure either, and it's a huge risk. And that's basically that equation shows you that you can fail your payment bottom up cracking and top down cracking equally if you have cement in the base, depending on condition. What people forgot, cement base, which Bernie Berenberg was pretty many times, cement treated bases were not introduced to prevent payments from cracking. They were introduced to slow down cracking, so slow down deterioration. But if you do it, but it was done for actual payments for Sinakara, which is different animal. In highway payments, when paving condition, we move paving miles and miles, paving condition change during the day and during the day. The chances that something goes wrong are huge, and cement in the base is a risky design, in my opinion. And SPS 2 results clearly support my conclusion. It's not just theory, it's field data.
Yes, sir. There was some work we did recently on the permeable aggregate bases and some guidelines on how to build them stable, you know, on the concrete. Any future work to bring them into the mid bay rigid or any other?
Oh, definitely, and that's a very good point. But people, I didn't want to bring it because it's slightly out of plan. But if you run, well, the way how MEPDG was developed, there was a division. Mike Garth was in charge for rigid part. Matt Witzek was in charge for flexible part. And Chuck Schwartz was in charge for base subgrade. But Matt Witzek moved from Arizona from Maryland to Arizona. And basically, Matt Witzek asphalt should be perfect. And what's below is not as important. So, and Mike Darter felt, well, subgrade and base are more important for asphalt than for concrete. And there are many, because of that, bases become no man's land. Many recommendations with Chuck Schwartz put together and Marge Professor Thompson, which sent volumes of materials, they kind of go cataloged and reported, but not actually used. For example, design guide recommends use resilient models with test. Try to put results of resilient model test into any software. Good luck. It's a second, but if you're successful, you'll find out that, at least for most cases, it affects nine. What's more important is the drainage coefficient. And that's what we're waiting for results to incorporate in PayMetMe, because the current, without the current, not PayMetMe, rigid, mean pave rigid. Because without the default factors, it's kind of it's meaningless exercise. But yeah, the short answer is yes, we'll look at this.
Yeah, a few years back, we had a concrete blow up in one of our roads. I was wondering why that is not touched in the analysis or the design. It's too rare, or what, if there's any reason behind it?
It's not too rare, but it's too difficult. Currently there is no good theory behind it, because there are two reasons. First of all, the majority of pavements which failed in the past were long joint spacing, and whatever you do theory develop for those won't be applicable for current pavements. And the second, there was a concept, the idea was that joint go up, it's a kind of loss of stability. So it's kind of a painted punch, like a buckling of the beam. And recently, the research in Germany showed that it's not the case whatsoever. But the short answer, it's a very important problem, but nobody has a solution yet.
Since you were making recommendations for future research, and the room is full of bright students here, just want to hear your opinion about the next fundamental really developments to be added to the design guide. Not necessarily the cases to be studied, but the fundamental model development. In particular, I'm really interested in hearing your thoughts about using fracture mechanics concept in here, because concrete is especially suitable for linear plastic fracture mechanics. And then why not staying away from those principles and then running everything based on a stress-based analysis?
We tried fracture mechanics many times in the past. And one of the papers which I mentioned, that my paper with Professor Roster, at that time I wasn't professor and he was a grad student, so in 1997. So basically, yeah, the people look at fracture mechanics for a long time. But the problem is, it slightly improves the solution when you already have a solution already. So far, it was failure to predict, to resolve any issues when a conventional stress analysis does not solve. I'm talking about for concrete parts, at least. Where it might help, we hope it will help, it's designed for the overlays. But even there, so far, just brute force application fracture mechanics didn't improve accuracy whatsoever. What's more important than fracture, hence my opinion, is so-called size effect. So you need to bring stochastics, you need to bring viable phenomena. But basically, so far, fracture mechanics was drastically over promising and under-delivered. I hope that I'm wrong, and in the future we'll see.
But not only from the models, from the models' perspective, but also having the experiments, because we're now relying on just the modulus of concrete. But now we are introducing a lot of new materials to concrete. You may literally get the same modulus of the material, but the failure characteristics of the material will change.
Here that's a different story. Yes, and you're absolutely right. For conventional concrete, there was no benefits to fracture mechanics. But there are situations, Professor Shaw actually brought it to Jefferson my attention in Colorado, which means already 10 years ago. For example, currently, if you try to justify the use of fibers,
exactly,
you don't get too much increase. Well, you might get some increase in modulus of rupture, but it still doesn't justify the cost. But if you bring that fracture mechanics-based criteria, then you can really do it. Yeah, here for new materials, that's definitely the case. For just concrete itself, it's not. But even there, it's more, we're talking about more, it's not just more accurate. Replacing stress analysis with J integral calculation. You really need to improve the models and justify the use of models. But the example you brought is very good, actually.
Yeah, but the other example you said is paramount, the size effect, and that can be explained.
Yes, the size effect, exactly, size effect, for example. One of the main problems with payment engineering is that every year we get a visitor from structure group, which said, well, we have this 3D, 4D, 5D fracture mechanics plasticity model. It works great for space shuttles, and great, it works great for nanolevels. We can definitely solve any pain problem you have. Just tell us all the inputs, and they start doing something, and you don't see them again later. but they already collect their check, though. So basically, people from Stash Field think that they can just bring their brilliant tools to payments and solve all the problems overnight. It's not the case. So it will require a lot of adaptation and a lot of thoughts.
You're talking about the secret concrete they use in the Trump Tower in Chicago.
What default value did you use for subgrade in Minnesota on your
We use A6 subgrade, H36 subgrade, whatever it comes. Which in reality not correct because half of the state has sand subgrade, but problems with that subgrade.
So MinDAT will use MinPay rigid instead of.
Yeah. Okay. Not will use. It's using. It was adapted. Right. Yeah,
it's on the flexible side. They really don't want to flexible.
Yeah.
I know.
Yeah. But for all last construction season and naturally before that, all the payments built during the last construction season were designed using payment in it. In paid region.
Did you notice much difference, Len, between your new scheme and what they've been building for the last 20 years?
Oh, yeah. So it's about at least an inch thinner, at least. But in some cases, 2-3 inches thinner. But on the other hand, we did not allow like 5-inch thick payments on the interstate highway system, which the industry pushed for. Well, thank you.